Hello everyone, today we are going to discuss about surface chemistry of the chapter of physical chemistry of class 12. So surface chemistry is the branch of chemistry which deals with the phenomena occurring at the surface of or the interface. Now the surface phenomena or the interface phenomena are important because there are multiple processes that are influenced by the surface action. One of the simplest example of surface action is the catalysis. We have already studied in class 10, 9 or 8 class hydrogenation of alkene, in which we use finely divided nickel, platinum or palladium. So basically finely divided nickel, platinum or palladium increases the surface area. As a result, catalysis is affected. So surface phenomena or interface phenomena are important. So under this chapter, surface chemistry, we will be discussing about adsorption, its phenomena, its thermodynamics, its equation, etc. Then we will discuss colloidal solution, then catalysis, then emulsion. So what is adsorption? Adsorption, it is the process of accumulation of molecular species at the surface rather than in the bulk of the solid or liquid is termed adsorption. So in case of adsorption, for example, you have an unused table kept for a long time, you will find dust particles over it. So this is an crude example of adsorption. Other example of adsorption, you may find silica gel or alumina gel adsorbing moisture from the environment, which is also a type of adsorption. So in case of adsorption, it is the accumulated substance will only remain at the surface and it will not percolate inside the bulk of the solid or the liquid. For example, dust does not go inside the material of the table, or in case of silica or alumina gel, the water molecule does not percolate inside, rather it is just sitting on the surface of alumina or silica gel, whatever is used for the adsorption of moisture from the atmosphere. So let us discuss some definitions related to adsorption. First one is adsorbate. Adsorbate are those substances which are being adsorbed. That is, if you take the example of dust and table surface, then dust particles are adsorbate. And adsorbent are those substances on which adsorption is taking place. That is, in this example, table surface is your adsorbent. Then there is a process called desorption. Desorption is a process of removal of adsorbate from the surface of adsorbent. So basically, desorption is the reverse of adsorption. Then we have another process called absorption. So absorption is a process in which the substance which is being absorbed is uniformly distributed throughout the solid or the liquid in which it is absorbed. It is different from adsorption in the sense that in case of adsorption, the substances which accumulates remain on the surface, but in case of absorption, the substances will percolate throughout the bulk and gets uniformly distributed. One thing is important: whenever adsorption start, it will start from adsorption, because it is simple. Until or unless the material does not come to the surface, how it will percolate through the bulk? And then there is a process called sorption. Sorption is a process in which adsorption and absorption both takes place simultaneously. To differentiate absorption and adsorption, we can take an example. You take a cotton and you dip in the colored water. Then you will see the whole cotton gets colored because colored water percolate throughout the bulk of the cotton. But you dip a piece of chalk in the colored water and remove it. If you peel off the upper surface of the chalk, inside you will get again a white surface. This shows that the color is only adsorbed at the surface of the chalk. This is how we can differentiate absorption and adsorption. Now let us discuss how adsorption takes place. So the driving force for adsorption is the unbalanced force on the surface or the interface. For example, look at the diagram of water kept in a glass. You observe two molecules of water, one molecule which is inside the bulk and other molecule which is on the interface. The water molecule inside the bulk experiences a balanced force, that is, from all the sides the forces are equal and cancel each other, resulting into a net force of zero. But assume a particle on the surface of the water, then you will see that there is a more amount of force acting downward compared to upward. As a result, whatever present upward will be accumulated on the surface, so that the unbalanced force is balanced and the surface energy which is caused due to unbalanced force is minimized. So driving force for adsorption is the unbalanced force that is acting on the molecules which are present on the surface or the interface of two media. Now, in general, at a given temperature and pressure conditions, whenever surface area increases, adsorption will increase, which is obvious. You take a small table, you have a small amount of adsorption. If you take a big table, if you have a big or large amount of adsorption. Another important factor for adsorption is temperature and pressure. If you vary temperature and pressure condition, obviously the amount of adsorption will be affected. How it will be affected, we will see in slides to come. Now, thermodynamics of adsorption. So adsorption is a phenomena for which enthalpy change, delta H value, is always negative. That means whenever adsorption takes place, some amount of energy will be released always. So whether it is Fizi adsorption, Kemi adsorption, or any kind of adsorption, enthalpy change will always be negative. Similarly, entropy change will also be negative. Delta S will also be negative for adsorption. Why? Because you assume whenever the substances are not absorbed, then they are in random motion. Once they get adsorbed on the surface, their randomness is lost, and this lost randomness causes the entropy change to be negative. For adsorption to be spontaneous, we know, for that matter, any chemical reaction or any process to be spontaneous, the Gibbs free energy change should be negative, because delta G negative is the ultimate criteria for spontaneity of any substance. So for adsorption process to be spontaneous, that Gibbs free energy change related to adsorption process should be negative, and this is only achieved if the magnitude of enthalpy change is higher than the magnitude of temperature multiplied by entropy change. So delta H, magnitude of delta H should be higher than the magnitude of T delta S. As a result, delta G will become negative. If it is not the case, then the adsorption process will not be spontaneous. Let us discuss about the type of adsorption. There are mainly two types of adsorption. One is Fizi adsorption or physical adsorption, and Kemi adsorption or chemical adsorption. Let us look one by one. So Fizi adsorption is a process in which adsorbate and adsorbent are attached with van der Waal force. So cause of Fizi adsorption is the van der Waal force. They are non-specific in nature. Fizi adsorption are non-specific because you take a table, you take a bench, you take a book, whatever you keep it, it will be dusted. You will get the dust over it. So it is non-specific in nature. It can happen at any place, irrespective of nature of adsorbent and adsorbate. They are reversible in nature. You can remove it, again it will come, you can again remove it. So they are reversible. Their enthalpy change is obviously low, because we know it's related to the van der Waal force. Adsorbate and adsorbent are attached with the van der Waal force, which is very big in nature. As a result, enthalpy is very low, but still it is negative. So enthalpy change is low, so low amount of energy will be released. On increasing temperature, fizzy absorption decreases. This is also okay because once you increase the temperature, the randomness within the molecule will increase, and as the randomness will increase, the adsorbent molecule will have reluctance to sit on the adsorbent surface. As a result, adsorption decreases. It will also leads to formation of multilayer, because you keep the bench unused for days and months, you will get many layers of dust gets accumulated on the surface. This suggests that whatever the surface you take, if you keep it for long time, you will get multilayer formation, or if you apply high pressure, then again multilayer formation will take place. There is no appreciable activation energy is required for fizzy absorption, because activation energy is more relevant in case of a chemical process, and fizzy absorption is just a physical adsorption which is caused due to van der Waal action, and this van der Waal action does not require any appreciable amount of activation energy. Then fizzy absorption obviously depends on the nature of the gas and the adsorbent surface, and it depends on surface area. Higher amount of surface area, higher will be your physical adsorption. Now let us discuss about the chemiabsorption. Chemiabsorption or chemical adsorption is caused due to chemical bond formation between adsorbent and adsorbent molecule. Now here chemical bond has to be formed. So formation of chemical bond is specific in nature. You will not find any chemical bond which is formed everywhere, because for chemical bond formation there is a specific requirement which has to be met to form the chemical bond. That's why chemiabsorption is always specific in nature. So wherever chemiabsorption takes place, it requires a specific type of condition. Similarly, it is irreversible in nature, because it's a chemical bond. Once it's done, you cannot go back. And as a result, it's a chemical bond formation. That's why enthalpy of formation is high compared to fizzy absorption. Then again, temperature increases the chemiabsorption, because here once you increase the temperature, the adsorbate and adsorbent molecule gets higher in energy, and this higher energy of adsorbate and adsorbent molecule leads to faster chemical bond formation, and thus chemiabsorption increases on increasing temperature, because on increasing temperature more number of molecules come into the zone in which they acquire the activation energy, or we can say with increasing temperature more number of molecules gets the required activation energy to form the chemical bond. As a result, chemiabsorption will increase. Then obviously it's a chemical bond formation, it's a chemical process, so appreciable amount of activation energy will be required. And once a site is bounded to an adsorbent molecule, then that site is blocked. On that specific site, you cannot have a second adsorbent molecule to get bonded. Thus, always in case of chemiabsorption, monolayer formation will take place, unlike fizzy absorption. Then it also depends on nature of the gas and obviously on the surface area. Higher the surface area, higher will be the amount of chemiabsorption. So the last two point, dependence on nature of gas and surface area, are common for both. So these two are similarity, and rest of the points are the difference between chemiabsorption and fizzy absorption. And this is very common question in your board examinations related to difference between the two types of adsorption processes. Now let us look at the adsorption isotherm. So before discussing about adsorption isotherm, let us discuss what is isotherm. Iso means same, therm means temperature. So a plot at constant temperature is known as isotherm. Similarly, you might have studied in your gaseous state chapter isobar, isocore. Those are the curves at constant pressure and constant volume respectively. So adsorption isotherm is the isotherm for adsorption process. So the variation of amount of gas adsorbed by adsorbent with pressure at constant temperature can be expressed by means of a curve called adsorption isotherm. So adsorption isotherm is basically used to express the variation of adsorption with pressure at some given temperature. So there are various type of adsorption isotherm. You have Friedreich isotherm, you have Langmuir isotherm, you have Bate isotherm, but for our syllabus we have to only study Friedreich isotherm. So Friedreich isotherm is based on Fizi adsorption. So Friedreich isotherm will follow the properties of a Fizi adsorption, and its equation is given by x upon m. X is the amount of adsorbed, m is the amount of adsorbent, is dependent on p to the power 1 by n, or which is equal to k into p to the power 1 by n, where k and n are constant, which depends on nature of adsorbed and adsorbent. N value has to be always greater than 1. So if you take the log of this equation, Friedreich isotherm equation, then you will end up log x by m equal to log k plus 1 by n log p. So if you plot x by m versus p, so it will be a curve representing different scenario. So whenever pressure is very very low, so you will find x by m will follow a linear equation as x by m equal to kp. When pressure is very very high, then you will find n value to be very high. So again, you will find x by m is equal to k p to the power 0. So x by m is equal to constant. So basically, after a certain value of pressure called saturation pressure, the curve saturates. That is, after a certain value of pressure, adsorption does not increase. And if you plot the log equation, then you will get a straight line with a slope 1 by n. So using this plot also, you can easily find the value of n and k in the equation. So at low pressure, the Friedreich isotherm tells the adsorption variation will be linear, but at very high pressure, the adsorption process will saturate. Now if we vary the temperature, see the plot, last plot, temperature variation. So if we vary the temperature, we know Fizi adsorption. For Fizi adsorption, with decreasing temperature, Fizi adsorption will increase, or vice versa. So we can say that plot at the bottom with T3 value has the lowest adsorption. So this has to be the highest value. That's why T3 will be highest, then T2, then T1. Because with increasing temperature, Fizi adsorption should decrease, and Friedreich isotherm is based on the Fizi adsorption. Now then there is a concept called adsorption from solution phase. So when people observed this adsorption process from solution phase, then they listed the observation which says the extent of adsorption decreases with increasing temperature. This extent of adsorption increases with increase in surface area. It depends on the concentration of solute in the solution, and also it depends on nature of adsorbent and adsorbent. So these four observations says that it is a kind of Fizi adsorption. So its behavior can be explained using Friedreich equation in its modified form, where x by m is equal to k c to the power 1 by n. So basically, for gaseous adsorption we used pressure, for adsorption from solution we used concentration, that is c. X is the amount of adsorbent, m is the amount of adsorbent, c is the concentration of the solution from which adsorption is taking place. Then let us discuss about the application of adsorption. So there are various applications listed here. For example, production of high vacuum, you use a charcoal gas which absorbs the gas molecule. So whatever, whenever you are using a vacuum pump, still there are some amount of gas that is left in the vessel or reaction chamber. So to get high vacuum condition, we use some charcoal which absorbs the gaseous molecule present over there on its surface and provides you a high vacuum condition. Similarly, gas mask, be used. Gas masks in which there are activated charcoal which absorbs the harmful or poisonous gas on its surface, and we get only useful gases to inhale. Then there is a control of humidity. We use silica and alumina to absorb moisture present in the environment so that we get a condition humidity free. Then removal of coloring material from a solution. Again, the coloring materials gets absorbed on the charcoal surface and the solution gets discolored. So and then heterogeneous catalysis, in which we have a solid surface on which gaseous reactions gets absorbed, reactant gets absorbed, and they react over there, then they produce the product through desorption. So in heterogeneous catalysis, adsorption process is there, and so forth and so on. So these are the application of adsorption. So I hope you have understood adsorption process. So in the next video, we'll be discussing the colloidal solution. Thank you.